Good morning. Well, I'm super excited to introduce our next speaker. You are all in for a treat. If you look at what's going on in the world today, the arguments you may face from your peers at your school, our next speaker is here to prepare you in that battle, those arguments. Robert Spencer is the director of Jihad Watch and the author of 17 books, including 2 New York Times bestsellers. His most recent book, which I would highly recommend, is The Complete Infidel's Guide to Free Speech and Its Enemies. And even coming up next month, he has the release of his newest book, Confessions of an Islamophobe. Spencer has led seminars on Islam and Jihad for the FBI, the United States Central Command, the United States Army Command, and the Joint Terrorism Task Force, and the U.S. intelligence community as a whole. He is a consultant for the Center for Security Policy and vice president of the American Freedom Defense Initiative. He is a weekly columnist for PJ Media and Front Page Magazine and has written hundreds of articles about jihad and Islamic terrorism. For nearly 10 years, Spencer has written the weekly Jihad Watch column at Human Events, and he has also served as a contributing writer to the Investigative Project on Terrorism and as an adjunct fellow with the Free Congress Foundation. Spencer has frequently appeared on television and radio programs such as Fox and Friends, C-SPAN, The Laura Ingraham Show, The Mark Levin Show, just to name a few. Among his many accomplishments, Spencer has also been a featured speaker with Young America's Foundation for many years and has addressed numerous universities such as Dartmouth College, the College of William and Mary, and many, many others. He is available for students like you to bring to your campus through our unparalleled campus lecture program. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to our next speaker.
Thank you very much, and always so great to be at YAF and to meet you all. And I wonder if you have ever considered exactly how ridiculous and absurd the contemporary left really is. But if we step back a bit from the battle and look at the kinds of things they're saying, it's absolutely laughable. Consider, for example, have you ever heard of Linda Sarsour? Some people have. Linda Sarsour, for those of you who have not, is one of the leading feminists in the country today. And if you ask the average feminist anywhere, really, who Linda Sarsour is, they will say she's a great hero, a warrior for women's rights. Linda Sarsour is also a Muslim who wears the headscarf, the hijab. And she says that's her personal choice. She wears it. It's nobody else's business. And that's great. However, it cannot be denied that there is a bit of cognitive dissonance there. You know what cognitive dissonance is? When you have two contradictory things being held together in one place, both of them can't be true. She's either a feminist or she wears the hijab, but she cannot be a feminist who wears the hijab. Why do I say this? Because of what the hijab is. Do you know what the hijab is? It's more than just a scarf. People will tell you, well, it's a sign that a woman is modest or religious, and that may be true, but there's more to it. In Islamic theology, the idea is that a woman is entirely responsible for making sure a man is not tempted. And if a man is tempted, it's her fault. So she has to cover her hair to make sure that she is not appealing and attractive so that men are not tempted. And you might think, oh, that sounds crazy. No, you couldn't possibly be telling the truth there. You must be a racist, bigoted Islamophobe. But in reality, 75% of the women who are in prison in Pakistan right now are in prison because they were raped. They are not the rapists. They are the victims. And they are in prison because they were not able to make sure that the rapist was not tempted to rape them. It's their fault. The whole idea of the hijab is that a man has no self-control and no responsibility for self-control at all. It's entirely on the woman, which is a very anti-woman, misogynistic concept. And so a feminist wearing the hijab, you gotta wonder. Also, there have been many, many women, unfortunately far more than we know or can possibly know, who have been murdered or brutalized for not wearing the hijab because they are not taking up their responsibility in the Islamic society to make sure that men control themselves. There was a girl in Mississauga, Ontario, in Canada, just about 10 years ago. Her name was Aksa Parvez. She was 16 years old, and she was a Muslim. She was raised in a Muslim family, but she went to Canadian public schools. She had non-Muslim friends. She wanted to be like her friends, so she would wear her hijab until she got out of the house, and then take it off down the street, go to school, come back, put the scarf back on, and go inside the house. Unfortunately, she got caught, and her father and her brother strangled her to death with the hijab she would not wear. Aksa Parvez, Mississauga, Ontario, 2007, right in the Western world, not in Saudi Arabia, not in Pakistan, not in Iran, but right in Canada. Now, that kind of thing has happened far more often than most people know. And there are many, many, many other women who have been brutalized and victimized in the same way. So the hijab, in short, is not a woman's rights statement. It's just the opposite. It's a woman's oppression statement. And so for a woman who is a feminist leader to wear the hijab just shows how absurd and ridiculous the left really is. And there's more. Just this morning, there came a news item out of Minnesota. Anybody here from Minnesota? No, lucky you. Now, in Rochester, Minnesota, there was going to be an event where a speaker who was a Coptic Christian from Egypt. Coptic Christians are about 6 to 10% of the population of Egypt. They have been oppressed for centuries. There is a low-level persecution and harassment that they have had to endure ever since the Muslim conquest of Egypt. And today, it's been even worse ever since the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt was toppled from power in 2013. The Muslim Brotherhood has blamed the Christians in Egypt for their loss of power. Churches have been burned. Christians have been attacked. Just last week, there was a bishop, a Coptic Christian bishop, and he was driving along in his car, and he came to a red light. And while he was stopped at the red light, a Muslim came out and stood in front of his car and would not move and demanded he get out of the car. Ultimately, because the guy wouldn't move, he got out of the car. The man started chasing him. There's video of this. Chased him down the street and stabbed him to death with a machete and carved a cross on his forehead. This is the kind of thing that Coptic Christians have to endure on a regular basis. So this Coptic Christian speaker in Rochester, Minnesota, he was going to speak. Flyers were distributed, and the flyers say, "Exposing Sharia and the Deception of Islam." Now, Sharia is Islamic law. Sharia is the Islamic law that mandates that women have to wear the headscarf or else. It mandates the denial of the freedom of speech. If you criticize Islam, you're likely to be killed. If you are a Muslim and you decide to leave Islam, then Sharia mandates that you be killed. You might not be killed, but that is the penalty in Islamic law. It mandates discrimination against women that is far greater than just wearing the scarf. A woman's testimony is worth half that of a man. A woman's inheritance is half that of a man. A woman can be beaten by her husband with no penalty. And there's a great deal more that is Islamic law. And the flyer also said, "Exposing Sharia and the Deception of Islam." Now, Muhammad, the prophet of Islam, he said, "War is deceit." And he allowed for lying in wartime. The jihad terrorists around the world, not all Muslims, but certainly the jihad terrorists, insist that they are at war with the West and that the United States and the other Western countries are at war with Islam right now, which would allow for deception on a massive scale. So this Coptic Christian was going to discuss this in Rochester, Minnesota, but the event was canceled. And the news report was really great because the guy at the venue, it was going to be at this club, the event, and where it was canceled. He said, "Well, you know, I'm kind of in favor of free speech, but this was going to be targeting an ethnic group." Now, let me ask you this. Is it really targeting an ethnic group to talk about the teachings of a particular religion that is held by people of all ethnic groups? What race is Islam? What ethnicity is Islam? Islam is a religion that is a belief system that is held by people of all races. So what ethnic group exactly was going to be targeted? But this is more of the ridiculousness and the absurdity that is so much pervasive in modern thinking. And the idea that it is wrong somehow to speak out about a system that mandates the oppression of women and even the beating of women, and that mandates the denial of the freedom of conscience and mandates the denial of the freedom of speech and mandates deception and lying, and that you're wrong if you talk about that, well, this is just more absurdity. Unfortunately, this is not just limited to Rochester, Minnesota. That happened just in the last few days in Rochester, Minnesota, but it happens all the time now. And Jolie told you that my next book is called Confessions of an Islamophobe. Have you ever heard that term, Islamophobe? You have. What is an Islamophobe? Someone who knows too much about Islam. You are the greatest. You win the prize. The whole concept of Islamophobia was invented in the 1990s, and it really took off after 9/11. And the whole idea is this, that there is some sort of irrational hatred of and bigotry toward Muslims, and that Muslims are victims and have to be specially protected and given special privileges and special accommodations because they are a persecuted, harassed, and victimized group. And that all sounds remotely plausible until you look, for example, at FBI statistics, which show that hate crimes in the United States happen to Jews because Jews are attacked for being Jewish twice more often than hate crimes against Muslims, and that there are hate crimes against all sorts of other groups that are far more common than hate crimes against Muslims. The idea that Muslims face wholesale persecution and harassment in the United States is total fiction. And also, the idea of Islamophobia works by lumping two things together that actually don't go together at all. One is this: vigilante attacks against innocent Muslims. And you may have heard the stories. A couple of guys, white, young white men, wearing Make America Great Again hats, go up to a girl wearing a hijab on the train or somewhere, and they pull off her hijab while saying, "Get out of our country." There was a very famous, a very widely publicized story that went exactly like that from New York City last year, right after Trump was elected. And then it turned out that the girl said, "Well, no, it didn't really happen. I made it all up." And there are a great many other stories like that that turn out to have been made up. But if there had been any incidents like that, then obviously they are reprehensible. Nobody should go around brutalizing somebody that they don't know and calling her names and tearing her clothes off and thinking themselves righteous. And they ought to be arrested and prosecuted. There's no doubt about that. There's no justification for that, no excuse, insofar as any of those incidents actually happened. But also called Islamophobia is any honest discussion of the motivating ideology that makes for terrorists. And that's where it becomes dangerous. There is an organization in the world called the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, the OIC. It is 57 Muslim governments around the world. That's a lot. That's a lot. It's high-level people, the highest level of the governments in those countries, and they are all members of this group. They all vote together at the United Nations. If you've ever noticed that the United Nations is uniformly and venomously anti-American, one of the reasons why is because these 57 countries always vote in the same way. And they vote against, generally, what the U.S. is doing. So, the Organization of Islamic Cooperation for years has been pushing this idea of Islamophobia. And by that, they don't just mean vigilante attacks against innocent people, but honest analysis of the motivating ideology of the jihad threat. And so, we end up once again in this position of absurdity and ridiculousness that would be very funny if it weren't so dangerous. Because it goes like this. The Quran, if you have your Quran with you, open it to chapter 9, verse 5, and you'll see where it says, "Kill the idolaters." You didn't bring it? Anyway, I never leave home without mine. Chapter 9, verse 5. kill the idolaters wherever you find them. Chapter 4, verse 89, kill them wherever you find them. Chapter 2, verse 191, seize them and kill them wherever you find them. Are you noticing a pattern? Chapter 9, verse 29, fight against those who do not believe in, do not obey Allah and his messenger, even if they are of the people of the book, which is Jews and Christians primarily, until they pay the jizya, which is a tax, with willing submission and feel themselves subdued. In other words, fight the Jews and Christians until they submit to the rule of Islamic law, which denies them basic rights. Chapter 47, verse 4, when you meet the unbelievers, strike the necks, cut off their heads. That's chapter 8, verse 12 as well. Strike the necks of the unbelievers. Chapter 3, verse 151, soon we will strike terror into the hearts of the unbelievers. That's Allah speaking, the supreme God. But in chapter 8, verse 60, he says to the Muslims, strike terror into the hearts of the enemies of Allah. So if I quote to you all that, that's all in there. And you can look it up. I gave you the verse references. There are plenty of others. We could go on all day. Chapter 98, verse 6. The unbelievers among the people of the book are the most vile of created beings. The most vile of created beings. That doesn't seem very nice. Chapter 48, verse 29. Muhammad is the apostle of Allah. Those who follow him are merciful to one another, but ruthless to the unbelievers. That's not quite love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. So, what you got is a religion that is calling for believers to make war against unbelievers. And you can say, oh no, wait a minute, Spencer, you racist, bigoted Islamophobe. There is violence in the Old Testament as well. And I will tell you, find it. Yes, go look at it, and you'll see, yes, there is violence in the Old Testament. There's slavery. There's all sorts of terrible things. But both Jews and Christians who believe in those books as scriptures have, because the Jews believe that the temple was destroyed in 70 AD and that those things pertain to temple worship, they don't take slaves or wage war or do these other things that are in those passages any longer. They don't think that they apply to nowadays. And because Christians believe that Jesus Christ fulfilled the old law and set it aside, they don't take slaves or burn cities or do any of those things anymore either. What's more, those passages that are violent in the Hebrew scriptures actually never tell believers to go and imitate and do those same things. And even when Christians were being violent in the name of Christianity in the past, they never quoted those scriptures and said, well, you know, because the prophet Joshua burned this whole city down and killed everybody in it, and God told him to, therefore, we must burn this whole city and kill everybody in it. They were never considered to be prescriptions for behavior. They were just descriptions of other people's behavior. But the Quran is prescriptive, not descriptive. It prescribes behavior. And most Muslim scholars believe that the passages that are violent take precedence over other passages that are more peaceful and are valid for all time. So you got a religion that ain't quite a religion of peace. Now, the thing about the Organization of Islamic Cooperation is this. When I quote to you all that, then I have just committed Islamophobia. And it's hate speech, it's racism, it's bigotry, and it ought to be outlawed, and I ought to be fined and imprisoned and silenced forever. However, when an imam quotes it, when a Muslim cleric quotes exactly those same verses, the OIC says nothing. Because after all, it's the beautiful expression of one of the world's great Abrahamic religions. And it's just that absurd, you see. When I quote exactly the same things that an imam quotes, it's okay coming from him, but not from me. Why? Because I disapprove of it. Now, you might think, oh, no, that couldn't possibly be the case. You got to be kidding, right? No. Riverside, California. Anybody from Riverside? Riverside, California, not long ago, in the Islamic Center of Riverside, the Imam Ammar Shaheen, you heard of Ammar? You might run into him, though. He's right there. Ammar Shaheen, he was preaching a Friday sermon. Muslims have the big day on Friday, like Jews on Saturday and Christians on Sunday. And on Friday, there's the sermon during the noon prayers. And Ammar Shaheen was preaching, and he preached, "Oh Allah, count the Jews and destroy them one by one and annihilate them down to the very last one." You've heard sermons like that in your church, right? And so Ammar Shaheen did not know that there was videotaping going on. And so the film went up at the wonderful site, the Middle East Media Research Institute, and at my own site, Jihad Watch, jihadwatch.org. Go there, bookmark it now. Jihadwatch.org, I put up the video, and I put up some of the passages from the Quran that say that the Jews are the worst enemies of the Muslims. That's chapter 5, verse 82. And that they are accursed by Allah. That's chapter 9, verse 30. And that they are the, I quoted you before, the most vile of created beings. Chapter 98, verse 6. And some others. That was all. I didn't make any other comments. Just quoted the Quran. And so I got a notice. All the Jihad Watch posts go up on Twitter. I got a notice from Twitter. Your post has been flagged for hate speech. And the post was, California imam prays for the destruction of the Jews. Now, mind you, Twitter didn't flag Omar Shaheen. That was okay. When he prayed, oh Allah, destroy the Jews, I don't know if it went up on Twitter, but I guarantee you if it had, they wouldn't have had any problem with it. The problem was my reporting on it. And not long after that, there was a Twitter hashtag. I don't usually go on Twitter, but I just happened to see this. You know those hashtags? You probably know far more about this than I do. They're these little phrases, right, that people say, make little comments on, right? You know what I'm talking about. Hashtags. So one of them said, confess your unpopular opinion. And I thought, well, I can't resist that. Sorry. So I went and I put in the little number sign. That's a hashtag, right? It's a number sign. But anyway, hashtag confess your unpopular opinion. And I wrote, Islam is not a religion of peace, but has doctrines mandating warfare against unbelievers. And sure enough, I got another note from Twitter. Your tweet has been flagged as hate speech. Now, meanwhile, there's this imam out there in Riverside, California, not in Saudi Arabia or Tehran, saying, oh Allah, count the Jews and destroy them one by one. That's not hate speech. You see, there was recently, actually a few years ago, there was an imam out of Saudi Arabia, and he had preached that jihad, the struggle to advance Islam, jihad is the smashing of skulls and the slitting of the throats of the unbelievers. Again, you've no doubt heard many sermons like that in your church, but in any case, jihad is the smashing of skulls and the slitting of the throats of the unbelievers. And he was going to go on a lecture tour in Great Britain. And he got in and spoke all around Great Britain. At the same time, I was going to go to Great Britain. And I got a letter saying, you have said Islam has a doctrine of warfare against unbelievers. And therefore, you are not allowed to come into Great Britain. And I am banned from Great Britain to this day. Now, I ask you, do you think that that imam, Muhammad al-Arifi, who said jihad is the smashing of skulls and the spilling of the blood and slitting of the throats of the unbelievers, do you think that he thinks Islam has a doctrine of warfare against unbelievers? I think he probably does. And yet, he's of course for it. He thinks it's great. So he gets into Britain. I agree with him that Islam has a doctrine of warfare against unbelievers, but I don't really think that's a very good idea. And so I am banned from Britain. And this is, of course, yet more of the absurdity of the current age. Now it gets worse. And I know this is very cheerful, but it does get worse. Not only have for years Islamic groups and their leftist allies in the United States been smearing any honest discussion of the jihad threat as bigotry and racism and Islamophobia, now they are moving to silence it altogether. Facebook, any of you on Facebook? Yes, a few. I guess it's passé now. That's good. Let's hope so. In any case, this is the story of Facebook. Facebook, pardon the personal reference, but this is actually happening not just to me, but to many others. Facebook used to send 20,000 people a day to Jihad Watch. You know, referrals. They would see a news story from Jihad Watch at Facebook and click on it and come to read it. 20,000 a day for years. But in February, that dropped to 2,000 a day. I believe that's a 90% drop, but I'm not very good at math. And it has never recovered. It's been way down there low ever since. Why? Did 18,000 people who used to go to Jihad Watch every day suddenly think, you know, this is Islamophobic? Or did something else happen? I'll tell you what happened. Joel Kaplan, the vice president of Facebook, flew to Islamabad, Pakistan in July. He was not going on vacation. He was meeting with Chaudhry Nisar Ali Khan, the interior minister of Pakistan. And he assured Chaudhry Nisar Ali Khan that Facebook would remove all material that was critical of Islam. You might think, oh, that's unbelievable. Way too far out. You racist, bigoted Islamophobe, prove that. Well, it was reported by Turkey's Anadolu News Agency. The Anadolu News Agency is a perfectly reputable news agency, and it's not given to publishing fictions. And moreover, it published photographs of the meeting of Kaplan sitting there with Chaudhry Nisar Ali Khan. And what's most interesting is none of the Western media reported it. Not the New York Times, not the Washington Post, not CNN, not MSNBC. Nobody said a word. But meanwhile, Facebook is removing, by its own account, 288,000 posts that are hate speech every day. 288,000. Now, how do they decide what's hate speech? Well, they ask Chaudhry Nisar Ali Khan. And there's the problem. Because in Islamic law, Sharia, criticism of Islam is forbidden. And that includes any honest analysis of how jihad terrorists use the teachings of Islam to justify violence and terrorism. That means it all has to be silenced. So Facebook is gone. And like I say, it wasn't just my site that happened to, but many, many others like it. Google. For years, if you would Google the word jihad, jihad is a fundamental concept of Islam. It means struggle, and the primary struggle is the struggle against unbelievers to establish the hegemony of Islamic law, Sharia. Jihad, for years, I have this website, Jihad Watch. I've been doing it since way before you were born, right? 2003. And, oh, you're older than that? Anyway, at Jihad Watch, I track jihad activity in all its forms in the United States and around the world. Every day of my life since October 2003, I know. Go see a movie, I know. But anyway, Jihad Watch would be the first thing that would come up if you searched for jihad. Because it used to be that Google was very straightforward. You would search for something, and you would get something that was on the subject you searched for and was the most popular result. And it's a very popular site. So you search for jihad, you would get Jihad Watch because it was the most on topic and popular. But now, after you clear your cache and your cookies and all that stuff, if you search for jihad, you will not get Jihad Watch on the first page. The only thing you will get on the first page is about how Islam is a religion of peace and that jihad is a spiritual struggle that has nothing to do with violence. Why did that happen? Because there was an imam in Texas named Omar Suleiman, and Omar Suleiman contacted Google and he said, you know, you have a lot of racist, bigoted Islamophobia in your search results. And Google said, oh, heavens to Betsy, how can we fix that? And Omar Suleiman said, well, you know, I'm very busy, but I'll see if I can find time to help. And he cautioned, he said, I'm not trying to get Google to shut down all criticism of Islam. I'm just trying to get them to shut down racist, bigoted, Islamophobic trash. The catch there is that there really isn't anything that Omar Suleiman considers to be legitimate criticism of Islam. If there's anything that's remotely critical of Islam, then Omar Suleiman really thinks that it's racist, bigoted, Islamophobic trash. And it all has to go. And that means including honest counterterror analysis. And so it's gone. Now, the thing is that between them, Google, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, all those social media giants, they have more control today over the means of communication than any totalitarian state ever had in the history of the world. You can talk about the Soviet Union, or Communist China, or Democratic Kampuchea, or North Korea today, or Hitler, any of them. And they wanted to control people's thoughts. They wanted to make sure that nobody committed thought crimes, but nobody had the power that Google and Facebook and YouTube and Twitter have today to do that. And so I applaud you all. You are all activists. You would not be here if you were not activists. And it's going to be tough because you are facing a very powerful, entrenched, ruthless, and evil foe. However, you do have one extraordinary weapon on your side, and that is the truth. What I've been talking about all this time is propaganda. It is propaganda that a feminist can wear the hijab and be a feminist, be in favor of women's rights. That is not the truth, it is propaganda. Propaganda being some ideas or thoughts that people who are powerful want you to have so they can control you more easily. It is propaganda that Islam is a religion of peace, and that any criticism of it is racist and bigoted and Islamophobic. These things are not true. These things are things that you are being told so that you will go along with the program that the people who are telling them to you want you to go along with. That's what propaganda is. But the thing about propaganda is that they got to churn it out by the pound. They've got to keep beating you over the head with it all the time because it's false. Because it does not correspond with reality. All you have to do is open your eyes and look at the world and you'll see the truth. And so the liars keep having to pump the lies at you to deceive you into rejecting the truth. But ultimately, the truth always wins. The totalitarian states, however long they lasted, ultimately they all have crumbled. Any future totalitarian states, even if we become one, ultimately will crumble. And I am asserting, I am exhorting, rather, all of you to stand firm and hold to the truth and hold on to reality in the coming days and months and years. As you continue in your activism, as you go on to college, as you go out into the world, stand up against the propaganda, stand for the truth. Know that the truth is the most powerful weapon, and that even if all you can do is whisper it, because all the loudspeakers and all the microphones and all the cameras are on the other side bleeding out their propaganda, your whispered voice is still more powerful because it's true. And it will still have compelling power among people because it's true. But this is not going to be easy. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, the great Soviet dissident. If you don't know who he is, look him up. I would spell it, but I might get it wrong. Anyway, Solzhenitsyn. Solzhenitsyn likened living in a totalitarian state to being a blade of grass and you're paved over by concrete and the light is gone, the air is gone, everything is darkness, and you're crushed. But, he said, ultimately you watch, and if it's not tended, the concrete breaks and the blades of grass poke through. You've seen that. The blades of grass ultimately are more powerful than the concrete. And this is the truth facing the powerful foes that are arrayed against it today. You have the truth, you are more powerful. And so I exhort you in closing, be a blade of grass. Thank you very much. So you have death fatwas or questions? I'm right here.
Hi, I'm Paolo Rosa.
Hello.
I'm from Potomac Falls High School. I live in Sterling, Virginia. I was here last month, and I asked you about how you got poisoned and like all like the whackness of that and stuff like that. But I was wondering, like, it got me thinking, like, how many death threats do you get on average? And like, do you take that as like a compliment or?
Yeah, I don't really keep account. I did just get a new one the other day. As a matter of fact, this guy on Twitter, he posted a picture of all these lit candles, and it said, Robert Spencer obituary. Well, it's sweet that he lit the candles. But anyway, I mean, I'm not really worried about it. It's not as if I'm not going to die if I don't do this work, you know? It's very much more important. I mean, I don't mean to sound pretentious. There was a great... one of the Muhammad cartoonists, you may recall that there is a satirical magazine in Paris called Charlie Hebdo. And in January 2015, Islamic jihadis went into their offices and killed 15 of the cartoonists because they drew Muhammad. And drawing Muhammad, it's forbidden. And before that, Charb, the editor of the magazine, Stéphane Charbonnier, he went by the Charb, he said, they said, well, aren't you afraid of the death threats? And he said, I would rather die standing up than live on my knees. And that's really the principle of a free person that all of us should hold to. And so, yeah, in a certain sense, I do take it as a compliment because it shows that I'm getting to them. At the same time, I don't have any illusions. But I don't want you to worry. Nobody knows I'm here this morning. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Oh. It's working.
There we go. I'm from Lompoc, California. I'm homeschooled, and my question is, so like you mentioned, quoting Allah earlier, you said, we will strike fear into the hearts of the unbelievers, and also I believe I'm doing a worldview class with some of my friends, one of whom is here, and when we studied Islam, we had to read some of the surah, and in there, in chapter 2, I believe it was, it says, alluding to the creation, it says, when we created the world and stuff like that. However, I was wondering how they explain that when admitting that God is more than one is the sin of shirk.
They don't explain it. As a matter of fact, chapter 5, verse 101 of the Quran, it's 101 and 102, it says, don't ask questions. Many people have lost their faith by asking questions. Better just go along. That's a paraphrase, but that's essentially it. And this is, in Islam, there are many, many contradictions like this. Like Jesus is the word of God in the Quran, is sinless in Islamic tradition. He's born of a virgin in the Quran, is going to come back at the end of the world in Islamic tradition. None of those things are true of Muhammad, and yet Muhammad is a greater prophet. Why? Not explained. Actually, it's because Islam was fashioned from various pieces of Christianity and Judaism and other things that were just sort of thrown into it without being understood. And in this case, the we is probably a reflection of the Christian Trinity, but in Islamic theology, it's just explained as a royal we, like kings and queens say, we are not amused, off with his head, you know. And it's just, it doesn't mean anything beyond that as far as they're concerned.
Hello, my name is Noah Burdett from Regina Luminous in Pennsylvania. You mentioned that the left side, their agenda is for Islam. Like, why? Why does it have to do with them? Like,
why does the left side with Islam?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a very good question. There's a whole lot to that. But if you think about the far left, whenever they take power, in Russia in 1917, in France in the 1790s, in China in 1949, everywhere else that the far left has taken power, there's a reign of terror. Because the left, you know, if you think about communism is going to establish the just society, the dictatorship of the proletariat in which all people are equal, right? Have you ever heard this? If you study communism, you'll hear it. But you'll hear it at college from all your professors. But in any case, the idea is that a just and equitable society in which there's no rich and no poor, but everybody is on the same level, that's the goal. But people are not equal. People are unequal in ability. And so some people will excel and some will not. That's just life, sorry. But that means that the only way you can enforce equality is to restrict liberty. And that means that you have to have a reign of terror. If you're going to make sure that everybody is on an equal economic basis, then you have to punish those who get out of line. And every leftist state has started with a reign of terror to establish its paradise on earth. Those who get out of line are cut off. Have you ever heard the term Procrustean bed? No one has. See, you're too busy studying multiculturalism and diversity nowadays instead of studying the Greek and Latin classics. And go back to your teachers and say, how come you haven't told me about Procrustes? Procrustes was a Greek tyrant, a ruler who was very unjust. And he would punish his enemies by making them lie on his bed. What's so bad about that? If you were too short for the bed, he would stretch you until you fit. And if you were too tall for the bed, he would cut off whatever was hanging off. So that everybody was equal. You see, that's communism. Now, Islam also wants to establish a paradise on earth in which justice reigns. And they do the same thing. It's a reign of terror. If you get out of line, you'll get stoned or your hand amputated or your head cut off or whatever. And so it is a earthly paradise established by a reign of terror. You see the similarity there? So I think they're real kin. They're blood brothers. They have an ideological kinship. But also, and much more easy to understand and faster, is this. Both the left and Islam hate America, and they hate Judeo-Christian civilization. And so they see, the left sees Islam, this 1,400-year war against the West and Christianity, and they say, oh, yes, we are allied with them because they hate the West and Christianity.
Oh, it's on. Hi, I'm Emma. I'm from Vancouver Island, BC, up in Canada. And I was on BuzzFeed's Instagram page, and I had commented on one of their Islam posts.
Yikes.
And I said, oh, I don't like darn Quran and Islam and stuff, and then these Muslim women are attacking me on the interwebs, and they're saying, oh, like, no one gets beaten or anything. I'm like, well, I'm just baffled that these women are supporting this like ideology that oppresses women, and I'm explaining to them that there's over 109 violent verses in the Quran, and I'm explaining all this evidence to them, and they're all still like, oh, like, I'm a Muslim, and I don't go through any of that. I was like, well, I don't get why you guys support this and don't believe the facts that I'm providing for you.
Well, note carefully what they're saying. I'm a Muslim, and I don't go through any of that. Does that mean it's not there? See, if any of you are Christians, you know that Jesus says, love your enemies and turn the other cheek. You ever heard that? Do you think every Christian loves his enemies and turns the other cheek? No, certainly not. But does that mean that Jesus didn't say it? I was speaking at University at Buffalo in New York. Anybody from around there? Lucky you. And University at Buffalo in New York, I really say I was speaking, I wasn't really speaking. I was really just standing there being yelled at for an hour and a half. And at one point, I did try to speak all the way through it. And I had a manual of Islamic law with me, a manual of Sharia, an Islamic book published by Muslims for Muslims. And in it, it says that homosexuals are to be executed because there was a young man sitting there with a sign that said, Queers Against Islamophobia. I started to read about how homosexuals are to be put to death under Islamic law from the manual of Islamic law. And this Muslim guy in the full garb, the kaftan and the kufi and the beard, he came running up to the Queer Against Islamophobia and hugged him and said, this is my best friend. Now, does that mean that Islamic law does not teach that homosexuals should be put to death? No, it doesn't. It's still in there. And it's still acted upon in Iran, in the domains that used to be held by ISIS, in Saudi Arabia, and elsewhere. But the fact is that rules are rules and people are people. And so there are some people who live and the rules are not enforced upon them or they don't enforce the rules. Doesn't change the rules. They're still there. So the Quran says good women are obedient. As for those that are not, give them a warning, send them to separate beds, and beat them. It's chapter 4, verse 34. You can look it up right now. And if they have never been beaten, that does not erase that passage from the book. It's still in there. And there are other women being beaten on that basis. Just the other day, there was a case where a man was beating his wife. And they went to the court this was actually several years ago in New Jersey, and the guy said that he didn't realize it was wrong. He didn't realize it was against the law, because it was okay in the country he came from, and the judge let him off. The judge should not have let him off, and his ruling was overturned by a higher court. But you see, he thought it was fine. It's in the Quran, and what we have is a great deterioration in the West now of the idea that there should be one law for all. And so there's going to be a lot more of that. Even though that ruling was overturned, there have been others. Anyway, those people, they're just not being honest with you. If they were being honest with you, they would no doubt know that even if they're not being beaten, they know people who have been. And they know that that's in there. Yes, sir.
Is this on? Okay, it is. Hi, my name is Charlie Dracy. I'm homeschooled and I live in California. And I was hearing what you're saying about Google and the censorship of information in that respect, and I've heard it in plenty of other respects. And I was wondering, what are the steps to take to reverse that? And is there a way to get your foot into the door for some other type of information distribution center, whether it's private or something other than Google? And what are your thoughts on that?
It's a very big problem, and there's no easy solution. But we should do all the things that you say. In the first place, there are three problems. I mean, three things that need to be done. One is we need to turn off Google and go elsewhere. And DuckDuckGo, I think it's called, is better, and Bing is even better. And try not to use Google as much as you can. But that's a small thing. They're so big, they won't care. But nonetheless, second, we need to challenge them in the courts. And there is a lawsuit in which I am a participant that is going through in the courts today that is challenging because Barack Obama, you remember him? The Section 230 of a thing called the Communications Decency Act actually protects the social media giants from legal challenge for their biases. And so we have to first try to get that removed, and then we can sue the social media giants. So we're working on that. Also, we need to challenge them on the basis of antitrust laws. Antitrust laws are designed to prevent the construction of huge monopolies that control all of the market for one particular product. And these do control almost all of the market for communication. So that has to be done. And that is, as far as I know, not being done, and I hope it will be. And finally, of course, we have to establish other competitors for it. And we can only hope that we will be able to do all of these things and do enough of each in time so as to end their monopoly before they close us off entirely. Yes, sir.
Matthew.
Speak loud. I will repeat it so that it's on the vid.
Why does the left side with Islam when the radicals would gladly saw their heads off? Is that not a death wish?
Well, yeah. Why would the left side with Islam when the radicals would gladly saw their heads off? Is that not a death wish? It might be a death wish, actually. I mean, of course, everything I explained before holds true. But also, there's a whole lot of people on the left who feel very guilty for being born white and American. And they think it's a terrible thing that they have to try to redress. And so they might not feel bad if they, you know, as the blade is slicing through their neck, they'll be thinking, isn't it wonderful how I was never racist? And so, yeah, I think that there could well be a death wish involved. But I think that they really don't care. They really don't take seriously the fact that these elements of Islamic law exist. They don't really believe, because they don't have any religion. They don't understand the religious impulse. So they don't really think that the Muslims have a religion or understand the religious impulse. They really think that the Muslims just want various economic and political advantages that they do not have now, and that religion is a way in which they express those desires. And so they don't really think that the Muslims believe in Islam. But they're in for a rude awakening. In the Islamic Republic of Iran, in 1979, there was the Islamic Revolution, and the Ayatollah Khomeini and the mullahs took over in Iran from the Shah, overthrew the Shah, who was a pro-Western secular ruler. And the communists, because they hated the Shah, because he was pro-American, the communists sided with the Muslims and became part of the original coalition government until they all got arrested and killed. And I think that's likely what will happen to the Western left should they succeed in their alliance with the Muslims in the West.
Hi, my name is Sarah Sesnick.
Oh, there you are.
Hello. I am from Toronto, Canada.
How's it going?
Pretty good, thanks. So right now, Canada has a lot of immigrants obviously coming in, over 250,000 each year. Many of which happen to be Muslim, and a lot of them happen to, like, they want us to change for them, like our
yes.
culture and everything. So I have a question. What do you think the dangers are that Canada is enforcing the M103 of Islamophobia? I was wondering what the dangers are for that.
Well, in the first place, you said they want us to change for them, and that's very wise and prescient statement, because that is exactly the case. There is an expression that I've often repeated at Jihad Watch in connection with various stories about Muslim groups, Muslim immigrants in the West making demands that places stop serving alcohol or make various other accommodations to Islam, even though they're not Muslim. And that is, when you're in a Muslim country, you should conform your behavior to suit Muslim sensibilities. And when you're in a non-Muslim country, you should conform your behavior to suit Muslim sensibilities. And that's essentially the mindset that they're working from. But what you're talking about with M103, M103 is a motion that was passed by the Canadian Parliament, and it condemns Islamophobia. And when it was passed, the people who were forwarding it, they said, don't worry, it's just a condemnation. It's not going to have any force of law. But now they're in discussions about how to attach criminal penalties to it. And I'm actually set to speak in Alberta next week, and so we'll see if I end up in jail. But in any case, I hope you'll bake me a file into a cake and come say hello. But anyway, the problem with Islamophobia is that it's ill-defined, as I explained before, that it's not just attacks on innocent people, but it's a speech restriction. And in the case of Canada and the motion M103, the only definition of Islamophobia that has been offered was offered actually by the Toronto School District when they were instituting an anti-Islamophobia curriculum. And they said that Islamophobia is dislike of Islam as a political system or a culture. Now that means, so if you dislike getting your hand chopped off for theft or getting your head cut off for being an unbeliever or being killed in whatever way for leaving Islam, or if you dislike the beating of disobedient women or all of the other aspects of Islamic law, then you're an Islamophobe and can be prosecuted. And so it's an extremely insidious measure. It would be the death of Canada as a free society if this goes through. And there's no sugarcoating that.
Okay. Yes, sir. Hi, I'm David Mattson. I'm from Vancouver, Canada. I love your videos with David Wood, by the way.
Thank you. David Wood's a great man.
Yeah. I was wondering, with ISIS like being defeated in the Middle East right now, do you think that Western Islamic terrorism will decline, or will it continue to run rampant?
Oh, actually, with ISIS being defeated, the Islamic State being defeated in the Middle East, it's only going to get worse in the West, because a lot of those ISIS jihadis are citizens of Western countries. And there is not a single Western country that has said, you can't come back. As a matter of fact, in Sweden, they're giving them preferential housing and jobs, paid for by the government. And in Britain, there are already quite a few who have come back who are just walking around loose, and nobody's paying any attention to them. Now, let me ask you this. Imagine, you remember World War II, if you studied World War II, yes? 1939 to 1945, people, you should learn the dates. And imagine if it were 1940, and a bunch of people in Britain go to Germany because they're Nazis. And they fight with the Nazis against the British. But then after a while, things start to turn bad. Germany's losing the war. And so in 1944, they decide to go back to Britain. Do you think Britain would have let them in? Probably not. And if they had let them in, they would have been immediately arrested and imprisoned. These people are enemy combatants. ISIS is an entity that has called for the murders of civilians in the West and has repeatedly explained and declared that it is at war with the United States, with Canada, with Britain, with France, with Germany, with the Western world. So to let these guys just come back in and go about their lives is just asking for more jihad massacres. And that's what we're going to get.
Hi, my name's Calvin. I'm from Sterling, Virginia. My question is, why over the past 100 years have Judaism and Christianity like reformed and gotten better, but Islam has like continued to be just rampant and savage?
Well, I don't know if it's the time frame is exactly right, but in any case, Judaism and Christianity certainly have changed a great deal over time, and Certainly Christianity, when you're talking about the history of the Crusades, although the Crusades were not at all what they're made out to be, and they were a late and small-scale defensive reaction to Islamic Jihad, but that's another story. But certainly there was violence done in the name of Christianity. There was the Inquisition and all that, and much more. And you don't find that nowadays. Now, one primary reason for that is because in the founding texts of Christianity, you don't find it. You don't find Jesus Christ saying, kill them wherever you find them. You don't find St. Paul saying the unbelievers are the most vile of created beings and be merciful to them, to the believers, but ruthless to the unbelievers. Instead, you find them saying, love your enemies and all that. And so without a sustaining foundation in the actual teachings of the religion, it was inevitable that that behavior could not forever be justified by the teachings of the religion, because the teachings of the religion didn't justify it. But in Islam, it's very different. In Islam, there are all those martial passages calling for warfare that I quoted before. There's also another one, chapter 5, verse 3, it says, this day I have perfected your religion for you. Now, how can you have a reform when it's perfect already? Reform is generally, if you think about Martin Luther, the first great Christian reformer, what he was going to do was, or the man you're named for, John Calvin, what he was going to do was, they were going to go back to the original, right? They said that the church had added all these things on to the original teachings of Christianity. They were going to cut all that away and get back to the basics, right? In Islam, if you cut all, in the first place, it's perfect. Chapter 5, verse 3 of the Quran. So you can't really reform it. It's perfect. But there have been people who have said, we're going to reform it in exactly the same way that Luther and Calvin did. That Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was one. You heard of the Wahhabis? You might hear that term as you go through life. And in any case, they're named after Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Wahhabism, which is a form of Islam, is the official religion of Saudi Arabia. And Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he lived in the 18th century. He died in 1792. So he was a contemporary of George Washington. And he was a Muslim reformer. He was going to cut away all the nonsense, all the later additions, and get back to the basics, get back to what the Quran and Muhammad taught. And Wahhabism is more violent and more intransigent than other forms of Islam. That's the reform. The thing is that the answer to your question in short is therefore that Judaism and Christianity teach peace at their core. So when people get to their core, they have peace. But Islam teaches warfare at its core. So when people get to its core, you got warfare. Thank you. I guess that's it. Thanks. It's been great.
Let's keep it going for Robert Spencer. All right, you guys have about a 4-minute break, so feel free to really, really quickly grab some coffee or water if you need it, but please stay in the room if you can.